you're always seeking perfection. Are you? Is your target to win every competition? Because you've got the Capital One Cup coming up. Do you want to win all four competitions you can? I know it's difficult, but is that the aim?
What the fuck? So Manchester City arrived once in their lives in the semi-final Champions League. So when the people believe I'm going to win the Champions League because I am a real good coach, I don't think so, guys. So.
Wow, that was loud.
Who's leading?
And we're back with Stand Up Pitches, everybody.
We have no lead today because everyone is just coming back from. Where the fuck they're coming back from?
Everyone's KO'd.
And we have a special guest in the house today.
Introduce yourself, special guest who's been on the show. This is what, number three?
Number two. This is the first time I'm meeting Khal for Sons of Pitches. We are here for football, so let's talk football.
Let's talk football.
Yes. So, first up, this week, our show is going to be a little bit different because we're not going to be doing your typical rundowns because, well... Honestly, even we're getting bored of it, right, guys?
No. Last week's game was pretty good, I feel. There was a lot of really nice games.
Yeah, but come on. We gotta shake it up. One time over.
We're gonna do something fresh now and then.
Exactly.
You know?
And then we're building up to episode number 25 soon.
23
la, but 25 soon la. Pukima, I say soon, guys. Anyways, to kick it all off, let's talk about Leicester City's current form. So, Yuan. Take it away.
Hey, Leicester. We'll talk about the Champions League and the Premier League and League Cup performance.
I'm very surprised that Leicester did very well in the
Champions
first match.
League? Yeah.
I mean, it's club broker, yes, but...
It's a start. It's a start for them. They have to start somewhere. And at least they're not going up against a big team.
Yeah, but you all see the highlight or not? Like, shit.
It was a shitty game.
So basically, Leicester won a base.
Yeah, thing is right now, I don't think CK gets to talk about Leicester. Anyway, he's just going to say it's a shitty game.
Okay. Fuck off.
I was struggling to understand what you were trying to say right there, and then I just realized that it was a beautiful burn. it was an easy win. I mean, the first goal was easy. Was it easy? Yeah.
I like Brendan Rodgers. You know, his first match is against Barcelona.
But which goes to show another point where even though it was a shitty match, Leicester prevailed. So are they proving something here?
No,
they're proving
really.
That they can play against shit, now, so
really.
It's a good thing. At least they're not losing against
shit.
They're
bottom of the shit.
They have a very easy group.
Not really. They're taking the games one at a time first. You know, they're concentrating.
I disagree. It's an easy group. You put Man United in that group, they will lose.
I think someone's just frustrated.
But yeah, you have to look at the other game as well. They won 3-0 against Burnley.
Which was okay.
Not bad, not bad.
Coming back from
something
the
that Liverpool cannot do.
No, wait. Yes, I was going to go there. Don't worry, but it was quite funny because if Burnley put up this performance against Liverpool, they might just draw 0-0.
So you're
but
just going to say that Burnley played like shit also?
They played like shit, bro. They conceded one own goal. My God, I don't know how they concede their own goal, man.
The defending was so poor.
And then
they will go down in like those reviews.
Andre Gray, who was very hardworking in that Liverpool match, his work efficiency also dropped. Mahrez scored a great goal. I wanted to mention in that Brugge game.
It's Brugge.
Brugge.
You know why? Because this guy from Amsterdam, I was taking a train there and I said Brugge. No, it's Brugge. I'm like, okay, fine, Brugge.
You want to talk about Slimani Islam?
Oh, what a
debut.
What a good game from him. Two goals.
Carl, any thoughts on Slimani?
Added more depth into the Leicester City squad.
Do you think he's someone who will compliment Vardy?
Compliment the squad, not Vardy. Compliment the squad.
Well, I mean, the squad has been lacking since Kante left. I would say he's backup. And they can mess around with a lot more formations.
So will he overshadow Vardy?
Nah. It's a team game, you know. It's a team game. When we talk about Leicester's triumph last season, we cannot single out one person. We had to single out the collective. It's a collective effort in the end.
Yeah, all the time monks.
It's interesting that you mentioned this because they played a lot of whiff in this game, and you could see them doing the same thing in the recent game. two goals down against Chelsea. They lost 2-4 at home.
What to do?
Did you guys,
what to do?
Did you guys watch the game?
No.
The highlights?
It was actually quite a sad game for Leicester.
What?
Quite a sad game for Leicester, are you sure?
You sure? Chelsea played them well.
I feel like both sides played very poorly though.
Really?
Yeah. No, but honestly, Chelsea did play decently. Okay,
I want to talk about Gary Cahill. He is in a shit form right now.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So, but in that game in particular, Fabregas.
Hey, but he's got two goals in the last.
Exactly, Fabregas is actually showing his old form again, in a sense.
But he took until extra
coming
time.
Coming from
to
Arsenal,
show
is it? Coming from an Arsenal fan, is it?
Oh.
Yeah, like, he took quite late, but
yeah. So, can you think you can do that? Aren't you supposed to deliver as early as possible in every game?
Agreed. I'm going to rebut with this, yeah? Have you seen Arsenal and Manu over the past few years? All the extra time goals that they had to do just to keep on winning?
Oh, forget time, you mean?
Ah, a win is a win,
see,
yeah.
You see, Johan just went...
They mentioned it. When you guys play futsal, do you guys want to play a full 7 minutes or do you guys want to play first two goals then the team goes out?
First two goals.
Or you want to play
actually,
full
no, play full 7 minutes.
Ah, there you go. I mean, like, it's a philosophical question. It's a philosophical football.
Okay,
yeah,
so
exactly.
Let's come back to the Chelsea game. Cahill alongside Lewis. Lewis came back from PSG. Is that the ideal partnership at the back? Because that clearly wasn't the case.
They were an ideal partnership before, but not anymore.
2012 especially.
But yeah, I have to say it's not anymore. Because Cahill is old. Lewis is...
He's old.
Yeah, he's old.
He's 27, right?
Is he old for...
Oh, he's old, he's old.
He's not 27, he's...
34,
right?
Yeah.
He's 30? No. That's 32.
I mean 33.
Sorry, 32. He's around he's around the 30s already.
Oh,
so
because
when
Chelsea bought him, he was already like 24, 25.
Correct. He was really in his peak.
Yeah.
From
and
a relegated bulletin to a Champions League side winning.
Lewis is not exactly too old either. He's probably in his peak also.
No, defenders you target between the 27 and 34, 35.
Okay, so what went wrong for Chelsea in this game then? Why did it take them extra time to finish off the game?
Ask Conte.
This is a very biased kind of response.
What do you mean by biased kind of response?
It's like, hey, Liverpool beat them, why can't Leicester beat them?
You're talking about Burnley, right? Better they beat Burnley, though they can beat Liverpool, but no, Liverpool beat Leicester as well, so in the shit.
And I just want to mention that Ranieri didn't put Vardy in this game. He played Okazaki up front.
Yeah, well, he scored.
Yeah.
He scored both of the goals.
I mean,
which were very weird in my opinion.
Really?
Why?
Like, no, because it was, you had to determine whether it crossed the line or not. It didn't actually hit the net.
I mean, at his age, I think Vardy deserves the rest that he had to take.
He's only fucking 29.
Exactly, he's 29.
It's a long season.
It's a long season. And you need to look after the longevity of your players.
Longevity. Prosperity burger.
Hey, fuck you guys, lah!
I had to throw it in.
But I understand what you're saying is sad for them because they were down to 10 men in the 88th
minute. Yeah, exactly.
Then they got into extra time and that was when Hazard came on. And from that point onwards, you knew that they were going to win the game.
It was hazardous.
Shut up.
Ayo. Yeah. You let him do that, yo, Johan. You just put it there, yo.
So this is the first time Leicester has actually gone through a busy schedule. They've actually experienced what it's like to be in
top-flight
football.
Yeah.
You know?
That's true.
How well do you think they will fare so far? I think they're doing decent.
They're doing okay.
They're doing okay.
8 goals in 3 games.
Yeah, that's
alright.
But whether they can keep this up throughout the next few months is the question.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, you can also consider Ranieri has the January transfer window to do another tweet if he wants
that's
to.
That's only
are
provided
sure?
they can get through the current situation. If they don't get through the Champions League group stage, which by what Johan said is an easy group. If they can't get through
an easy group.
They can't get through that. Then there's no point in Ranieri trying to reinforce the squad in the January transfer window.
Is it not easy?
Or...
There's like only Porto there that's tougher for them.
Yeah.
Porto will trash them actually.
Porto has the experience of
Champions
League.
Yeah. Porto will trash
Porto playing against them away at their own stadium.
Okay, okay.
What's the stadium called? Estadio something lah. Okay.
Yeah, that's a good answer.
Estadio something lah. Okay. Portuguese sides traditionally in the Champions League they're very tough. Braga in the past.
Yes.
Sporting Lisbon.
Look at when Liverpool came back to the Champions League, we had a Portuguese team who would play against Benfica. It was tough. We lost to them also.
Going back to US one, I agree with Johan. It's an easy group as compared to you. I don't want to shit on Brendan
Rodgers
on time.
He will definitely go to knockout. It's just how long
they
will last.
Definitely
last
16.
Last 16.
Where was the last time you guys did this like prediction? What happened?
Exactly. I'm like,
last time we did a prediction was last week.
You guys
CK was correct.
What I mean is about the Euros.
Oh my god.
Don't throw back!
Moving on to Chelsea versus Liverpool. CK, take it away.
Let me shit on you, Henry. But shame on you! As a Liverpool fan! Shame!
Shame! He doesn't watch Game of Thrones.
Shame!
He won't understand that.
Talk about the game.
Okay, basically, the first goal itself, you can see why Liverpool converted the goal itself, right?
Yeah.
If you re-watch the match itself, it looks like six defenders.
In Chelsea, right?
Inside the box.
Yeah. It's not typical Chelsea player.
Oh, it's not typical.
It was like, they didn't park the bus, they parked the car there.
Yeah.
So, legit, right? There was just six players marking each other.
And Lovren was just ball watching. Him. It was ball watching. Mm. Classic goal to score.
It wasn't a really good goal, I would say.
It was a good goal in terms of position-wise. He was at the right place at the right time.
Which comes back to Johan's question just now. He said that, was Cahill, you know, his shit form? That plays into it.
I mean,
well,
a goal is a goal.
When the moment who crosses Liverpool, who is that again?
Is it Mane?
I don't think it's Mane. I think it was Coutinho who crossed the ball.
Yeah.
When the moment they crossed the ball, Cahill realized something was wrong. He ran to Lovren, but all the five players are still there.
I think that's the problem with a lot of clubs this week. They were caught all ball watching. Very, very bad defending for this week. Especially Manchester United.
Is it because
Manchester United.
Is it because they just came back from an international break?
I don't think that should be the
case. This is only the second week after the
international break. Having the proper rhythm of matches.
But how many
coming
people
in?
Actually play in the international break?
No, what I mean is, you don't have a game for the last 12 days.
Okay.
So you don't have that cohesion in during a match day in your fixtures of having the crowd.
But that's what training sessions are for.
No. Training sessions.
I get what Khal is saying. Perhaps this is a more mental kind of thing.
Yeah, because
with them not being prepared
This would be an anomaly.
I feel like this shouldn't be a problem for Conte because we predicted him to have a great form in this Premier League.
We were surprised.
Yeah.
Was he
correct to use this tactic against a 4-1-4-1 against Liverpool?
Not anymore. not anymore. Look, Klopp is playing his first season as a manager for Liverpool.
First full season.
Conte is coming in as a new manager. Both of them have not played each other yet.
They have not exchanged.
No. So this is the very first time that Chelsea and Liverpool are playing with new managers and different tactics. So you have to give him the benefit of doubt for experimenting. So now he knows.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure the next match that we're going to play against Chelsea, which is probably next year
at Anfield,
you're going to lose that.
We're probably going to have a problem.
Say now. Also, Izam had to rewind the next time.
I don't want to say that we lost. To be fair to CK, yes, it was wrong for me to doubt Liverpool. but wait. Shut the fuck up, wait! Here's the thing. I was being real. I was really being real.
I was being real too.
No, you're not.
I was being real too.
But honestly speaking, there has to be a sense of realism. On paper, it really, really proved that Chelsea was a stronger team.
I mean, even if you're looking at their past few games, Chelsea was a bit more consistent
stronger
compared to Liverpool.
But props to Liverpool for proving me wrong.
The ball is round, lah.
Yes.
Props for Henderson.
You want to talk about your second half performance?
exactly. See? What was that, CK?
No, let's talk about Henderson. Okay, would you agree that it was Henderson's best game?
To be fair, statistically, he performs better against Chelsea. You know, he scored crackers in against Chelsea.
Yeah, most of the time, yeah, actually.
When Henderson first came in, Dalglish's first season, we knew the season was shit already. Chelsea was going to win Champions League. We beat Chelsea 4-1.
Yeah, I want to put these two players, Henderson and Sturridge, these two players.
Who's more shit?
No. Sturridge proved himself in Chelsea's match. He didn't play very well in Leicester's match, but he showed up against Chelsea.
Redemption!
But he showed up against Chelsea.
Is it the second coming of Benteke, if you feel?
I hope not, I really hope not. Sturridge has provided us.
Oh, you like to jinx your own club.
I know.
Moving on to Manchester City.
He's not done with his question yet.
Sorry, what was your question, CK?
He was asking who's more shit.
I still think
Henderson
is
more shit.
Yeah.
We've got that.
It's just one goal. It's just one.
Yeah,
goal.
Exactly. That's what I said.
Sturridge
might be the best goal that he ever scored, but
in his
career,
right? Yeah. And Sturridge, he needs to prove himself because he only has that much time with Klopp. Klopp is giving him a lifeline here, and I tell you, if he doesn't take that opportunity or doesn't appreciate the thing that Klopp gives him, he's gonna be fucked, dude. And I don't want to see Sturridge fucked because, honestly speaking,
he's been a very good player.
He's been a good player for Liverpool.
You know who else is gonna be fucked? A lot of Manchester United players.
Yay!
Moving on to Manchester City.
You want headline for this, right? Was Manchester City invincibles in the making again?
Nope.
Fuck you! There's only one invincible, and that was the Arsenal team back then.
Nah.
That's it.
Your declaration.
Well, It's a good squad. I mean, it's a quality squad, what Man City has.
With a quality manager, don't forget.
With a quality manager.
And
it's just
swear.
That, you know, it's going into the doing another Invisibles. Like a few seasons ago when Mourinho came back, everyone said Chelsea's gonna be the Invisibles for that season.
No, they were the Dark Horses.
No. Two seasons ago.
He did say that. He said, oh no, we're not gonna win title this season.
Okay.
We're gonna come in second.
Or whatever. So it's really impossible to replicate that again. I mean, like, seriously, the condition.
Why would you say that?
No, I think the. If you, back then, money wasn't so prevalent, you know, paychecks weren't prevalent, togetherness was above all else, you know, so this Manchester team, yes, they have the togetherness, but during the tough times, I want to see whether they can churn out those results. You know, I want to say, if you can beat Stoke City 1-0 away on a cold rainy night, you guys are proven can be champions or whatever. A long time ago, the Arsenal team, they grind out results together. The only thing that the Arsenal team would have regretted, not doing well in Champions League. What Man City wants, they want to prove themselves that they're the powerhouse again after that last season, and as well as they want to prove themselves even further in Champions League. I think the shift, the tone has been shifted equally between winning the Premier League and also winning the Champions League.
Let's not forget, now with money coming into play a lot more compared to way back then, the January transfer window will always be something to look out for. Back then, the January transfer window was only a transfer window that was used to 45 whoever was injured to help out around the squad. But now the January transfer window is not just for the injuries, but it's also to see, okay, we did wrong here, we're gonna get a new player here, we're gonna
let's throw another player out.
Yeah, exactly.
Like Wilfred Bony.
Is your point that even if Manchester City really do go, say for example, a metaphor or a hypothesis, undefeated, they should never be worthy of the title Invincibles because
it's still early on in the season. You know, I'm speaking from a certain bias.
So you do acknowledge that to a certain extent your statement has this elements of biasness.
Exactly. I'm willing to put that on record. But however, the season is still long. We're 5 games in. Back then, didn't do well at the start of the season, correct? If I'm not mistaken.
I mean, when does Arsenal ever do well at the start, middle, or end of the season? But that's all.
No, I mean, back then, you know. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I mean, okay, it's correct. We did have quite a few draws. So.
Correct.
It's all about gaining momentum, picking out the getting out the result.
Because Khal did put it on the record that, you know, he is being biased.
Yes,
I wanted to ask a third party panel.
Think of the word first,
I would say it shouldn't be biased because anything can happen. City can actually bring
well,
it with that team.
I would only say City will deserve the whole Invincible thing.
No, they will beat the Invincibles.
I mean, if
I'm
they
putting
do.
That on record now.
Okay, are you willing to take a bet?
No.
Are you willing to take a bet?
I should take a bet yesterday. I mean, last week.
But you didn't. Okay, but again, back to the whole Invincible thing. I don't think that, I'm putting this on record,
I'm using that word now.
Look,
I don't think the squad isn't worthy of becoming the Invincible.
Because it was purchased.
Yes, purchased a few seasons ago, because this one wasn't really...
Just what I was wanting, I was trying to clarify that with Carl earlier on that. Even if they do go undefeated, they're not worthy of the title because this squad was built with money.
So who will they be then? Okay, let's talk about it this way. If they do go 50 games without losing, then fine. That means they did better than Arsenal. They do deserve the whole term.
Invincibles.
But
it's going to be realistic.
It's like the Invincibles.
It's not easy. It's really
it's
not
easy. But whoever accomplishes that, props to them.
Yes.
Because what we're saying here, what we're arguing here is, are they going to be able to replicate the same thing that the Invincibles of 2003, 2004? Would they be able to replicate the same thing? But right now, what we are at a standpoint is, we don't see it happening because they were bought.
I mean, a lot of us are still
they are the Invincibles? No, they're not. So a lot of people will say that because you guys bought everyone. The general Arsenal Invincibles.
But this is a Guardiola team. He was given this team instead of buying them.
Right,
so,
okay.
That's another variable.
Yeah. Yeah. Let me propose this, we come back to this case.
End of the season.
Next week?
No, we come
end
back
of the
to
season.
This case
next
at the end of December. Yeah.
Next year,
January.
After Christmas.
Okay, so Johan jot this down, our producer. Thank you.
Unboxing there,
Speaking of Guardiola, earlier on in the clip, you heard him say what the...
I've never heard anyone from the Premier League say that.
Well, to be fair, that was a stupid question from the reporter.
It's the one that managers hate press conferences because they keep asking the same question.
I mean, it's the same as me asking Khal, hey Khal, where do you think Arsenal is going to end up this season?
Above Spurs.
Above...
Speaking of Arsenal, we are going to move on to the talk set of Arsenal, which I'm pretty sure both Khal and Izzah are going to enjoy.
I prefer the whole City shit and they didn't even speak a single shit. Fuck off! Well, okay, the thing is, okay, are we going to Arsenal or do you want to, like, do you want to
pinpoint? I like John Stones, that's all.
I like John Stones.
So, future of England!
True,
very true. Yeah, what was it that you told me the other day? It's finally time.
It's finally time for the season for Arsenal fans to get really hyped up. Seriously, Jaka. Stoke City could be relegated.
Talking about Arsenal, their current form is from their last five games, they've had four wins and one draw. Surprising.
Talk about the role of Granit Xhaka.
Arsene Wenger is just waiting for Ramsey to come back because.
Fully back on form.
He talked about combination plays between midfield pairings and so on, so hence why Santi Cazorla and Francis Coquelin are getting the games compared to maybe a Xhaka Cazorla combination or Coquelin, whatever.
And if you watch the Hull Arsenal match, also Xhaka and Coquelin.
So I mean, like, it's all about testing all these combinations in different types of situations. Yeah, and also keep in mind that was Granit Xhaka's like second full on game away.
Yeah.
You know, so to get that experience of at an English team and so on and so forth.
Okay, also speaking about Xhaka, before we go to Henry's question, he likes to score from that one spot.
That goal was sex though.
Same goes to Henderson.
At least Xhaka scores. Anyway, my question would be, sure, Xhaka is being tested out, but wouldn't you say that there's a fine line of experimenting where you see clear frustration from Xhaka one day? Like, can you stop experimenting on me and at least let me play my games already?
All right.
But you're only 5 games in.
Still, 5 games in is really...
Yeah, I have to agree. I have to add up on that. Everyone really thought that Xhaka would have played against PSG.
See?
Because of the fixture list and whatever this and that's Mutala. I think what Wenger is trying to do is that he's trying to find a try a bit, because Cazorla and Coquelin has been tried and tested in the past. So again, away and an away game to PSG, trying out a new combination is quite
But then the game is
risky as well.
It was actually quite a bad game for us, and we were very lucky. Yes, CK has multiply pointed out last podcast. Yeah.
Okay, so now let's assume that luck has run out. Has it run out?
I don't know.
That was 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, exactly.
But Arsenal winning against Hull, tada Hull. But yeah, okay.
And you wonder why Guardiola doesn't like English press.
But I want to talk about the Arsenal game. I've talked about Perez before. I talked about how Perez is more of an on-ground player rather than the target man like Giroud. And we see him doing that role itself in that game against Nottingham.
Do you think that that's what Arsenal lacked the past few seasons though?
Arsenal likes to play in general.
On the ground?
How many games has Perez played so far? Only this game?
Two games. Sunderland, a bit against Southampton. He started against Southampton.
Oh, Southampton.
Got it from bench against PSG, if I'm mistaken, and this game.
So, do you think he lives up to that Spanish Jamie Vardy?
I think that was
a genuine, authentic Nola.
Nola.
No, I mean, like, what Wenger has been searching for the past maybe 5 to 7 years is an Eduardo-type player.
Mm-hmm. Eduardo.
And a fox-in-a-box type of player, because we haven't seen those type of players being produced for a very long time. Last time we seen it was Jamie Vardy.
Mm.
You know, so a lot of people are looking towards this tall, mobile striker like Lewandowski, Ibrahimovic, Morata, Benzema.
Mm.
You know, those tall, strong, mobile striker. You know, but this one is much more of a flair, pure technique. Pure intelligence player.
I can see the picture of the man named Chirut inside your head right now. It's like your forehead just...
So why... Okay, run by me again. Why did Arsenal decide to buy Chirut?
He's French.
What was it that attracted Wenger actually signed Chirut?
Yeah. Minus the fact that he's French. Minus the fact that he's French.
No, so actually, this is what I can clarify, because during that summer transfer when Van Persie went to Manchester United, a lot of people thought that Giroud was going to play as that backup striker to Van Persie, assuming that he signs an extension.
Yeah.
Like, then. So Giroud was essentially a second choice, like what Perez is now. So
but shouldn't Perez be first choice?
I mean,
to be fair to Giroud, over the not last year but the year before and the year before that.
Since he joined.
I mean, he's
statistically beautiful, but basically as useful as a chocolate kettle.
Chocolate kettle?
I mean, Johan is not wrong. He knows that it's very hard for me to talk about you.
I'm just helping him elaborate. But looking at Arsenal's current form, do you think they will still end up in fourth place? Definitely
yes.
Above Tottenham, yes. Of course.
Sure or not.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, if you're asking me, I feel like Arsenal has potential to go all the way this season.
Give it until game 12, game 14.
But yeah.
Then we can see the shape of the table.
But if you want to say game 12, game 14,
but
last year at game 12, game 14, we were actually quite high up. Then you remember what happened.
It's a shape. It's a shape that we know what we can expect for towards the end of the season.
As an Arsenal fan, I'm happy to see that they're performing really well right now, and I'm just afraid of their consistency. That's
oh,
it.
Don't worry, you can trust our consistency.
Hey, that's my line, huh? That's my line, huh?
Don't be afraid of the consistency, man. You're still going to the playoffs of the Champions League, that's alright.
Moving on.
No! United! No! Okay, we're gonna do it this way.
No. United has been shit, that's all.
No, I'm gonna sit here, y'all can ask me anything.
Okay, you want. Tell me this, huh?
100 million, huh?
Pop punde! Have you guys used 100 million?
Pop punde!
On that crap!
Pop punde!
Doesn't even know how to pass!
Pop punde!
Justify that.
Pop punde!
My question is very simple. Did Sir Alex Ferguson, before he decided to retire, do you think that he left the team... do you think that he knew that the team was going to this direction compared to, you know, I'm just going to build a team for the next person so that when the next person comes in, he can take the team
to answer
better.
Your question.
Like, Pellegrini for Guardiola.
Okay,
yeah.
To answer your question,
he's ignoring my question, by the way.
He chose David Moyes for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
Probably because he felt personally as a manager, David Moyes had what it takes.
Mm.
Probably shares the same kind of managerial style.
Mm.
The way he does things is similar to what Sir Alex Ferguson does.
He
fucked up in that decision.
He's still holding grudge.
50% he fucked up in that decision, and 50% the fans were not entirely backing Moyes yet because we wanted instant gratification.
That is
my justification.
Alright, so
he thought that he could leave the team halfway being not built yet to Moyes to rebuild the team because Moyes basically built Everton's framework.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay. So,
for the Pogba question.
No, Pogba question you can answer later.
Okay.
But,
we have time for like what?
I don't care about time right now. Following up on the Moyes thing, how about Van Gaal?
Picking Van Gaal was not Ferguson's choice.
It was
a decision made because fans were pressuring the club management and Ed Woodward had to make a decision at that point of time in the market who was available. And Van Gaal seemed like an appealing choice. So Woodward went for the kill. And then we fucked up as well because clearly he had
there was then one vine. That I love of, I think it was Van Gaal who was drunk at a Manchester United near a celebration.
Oh, listen to me.
He was like,
oh, listen to the
man. Yes! We go for it! That was such a beautiful.
Hey, but to be fair,
I still love the moment. He goes, hello, hello.
To be fair, Van Gaal being at United has given us the best
season we ever had.
That last season when he was there.
Not just last season, he's given us the best jokes.
Like horny and falling on the floor for no apparent
questions, guys. It's a press conference.
Okay.
Wait. I want to follow up to that question. Pop back or pop punde?
To answer your pop bar question,
pop punde.
Mourinho has basically answered that question for you. What he told Pogba was spot on. Forget your fucking price tag.
Mm.
Okay.
I tell you what I saw in the Feyenoord game. He was trying to be more than who he thinks he is.
Well, that's
so
what you get.
You are a defending midfielder. You are a DM. Okay? Typically, we play you in a 4-2-3-1 position. You play that too.
Correct.
Your role is to link up defense, link up all the passes from the back up front.
to midfield.
Okay.
He's trying to do more than that. Every time he gets the ball, he doesn't pass. He either pulls off a shitty pass or he tries to barge in like a monster. Then tries to pretend he's Harry Kane pretending to be Cristiano Ronaldo.
I think what Jamie Carragher and Phil Neville were mistaken. Pogba left Fellaini isolated against the Man City game. You know, Pogba tries to really live up to his name. But however, what he should do, I'm pretty sure that he is thinking that right now, at this current time, to rediscover what got him there.
Alright, so here's another question, yeah? There have been rumours about Manchester United having fallouts in the dressing room.
Yeah, and to follow up on that as well, apparently everyone is saying that Mourinho is a nasty manager in United.
I'm not surprised.
I mean, he's...
That's why, from the start, when he appointed Mourinho, I was never in favour of the decision.
Yeah, a lot of... It was a split.
I was never for this decision. That's why I've stated again and again since we started the podcast for this season. It will never be the same again for Manchester United fans.
Okay.
Because how are we supposed to feel? Especially, I'm not talking about the plastic fans. How are we supposed to feel? Arsenal, at least you guys can still be happy about being in fourth place. We don't know where we are. We have no guarantee of where
their
we are.
Their identity.
Going.
Identity.
Is yeah, like identity. Because you guys come in on basis of we have history, we have a legacy to follow. You bring in Jose Mourinho, it's going
to
break the legacy.
Welcome to Liverpool.
No, it's not going. It's not. It's that it's going to break the legacy. It's they want to. They're trying to keep that legacy, that cultural identity we have by using fast track solutions.
And
when the key to solving this kind of intrinsic problems
is a long term
blueprint.
Yeah,
Ed Woodward lacks that. I have no doubts if Ed Woodward were to be appointed to, I don't know, Barca or City's board, right, they would be damn happy. He's damn good at purchasing players. I will give you that. How many world-class players has he signed over the past few seasons?
Di Maria.
But every single one of them is a flop because you don't buy them at the right time. You're buying them like by trying to, you know, oh my god, this club is buying this player, I better buy someone as good as well.
Yeah.
Okay. And another thing about that as well, to point into that direction, is I have a feeling that... How is it? Pogba's decision to come back to United was not a mistake, but the way he came back to United was a huge mistake for him. You know why? Because they slapped a huge price tag on him. Is he that valuable? I don't think so. He is a good player in Juve standards. In Italy, he's a good player.
I disagree. He can create a legacy of his own at United,
okay.
But he needs to stop being so... He needs to put on his ego. He has to play with the team, not alone.
Okay,
so now that we finish.
Now, let me finish. Juventus, right, has been champions for how many seasons? 3-4 seasons, unbeaten, okay? And Italy's league has dropped in standards by a long shot. They basically... There is quality. This quality, but the quality has seen a sharp decline, and it's very unfortunate.
Basically, let's just say it in this way, they're not even playing the Italian games on TV anymore.
No, see, the value has dropped so much, but to have someone like Pogba come back to United in a 100 million price tag, right, was to me the worst mistake that a player can make.
I want to go back to your Mourinho question about the dressing room problem. I watched the game during Watford, we were 2-1 down.
Mm.
He was like, what? Basically, Brendan Rodgers in the Champions League. So he was just there.
Chewing gum. No, I said he doesn't chew gum.
Just
standing there looking
like... You know, if it was Guardiola, right, he would be at the dugout. He's doing all these hand signs in his
very animated.
What you need to do to reorganize your whole formation.
Fair enough.
He was just there. But you as a manager, people are looking up to you. Dude. Coach, tell me what to do next. How do we get back from this?
Nothing to
say. He didn't do anything. He was just there. It's like...
Was Mourinho like waiting for that... that guy for the upcoming FIFA 17 Hunter?
Oh, come on. Okay, guys.
Last thing...
Remember the number, number 29, fuckers.
Last thing
29,
before we move on. Right, last thing before we finish up on Manchester United, let's talk about an elephant.
No, it's not an elephant, it's an ogre.
Shrek? Okay. Before you give your thoughts about Wayne Rooney, I want to ask you this, yeah? We've seen that Wayne Rooney is the last of a generation of Manchester United players that have carried on the legacy of Sir Alex Ferguson.
Mm-hmm. He's the only one left.
Time to go.
No, not the only one left. No, they still have Carrick.
Smalling, Carrick.
Smalling.
Okay, back
I mean,
here.
The last of the big name,
bigger
faces are Alex Ferguson's time. So tell me this. Where does Rooney fit into this current Manchester United right now? And what is the best way for Rooney to, well, continue in his career?
Play for another season. Try playing in a...
Attacking
position.
Deeper.
Deeper in attacking?
Yeah.
No, defending?
defending.
Wow.
Play him in a deeper position.
So,
okay, here's my argument. When we made him captain, we relied on his leadership. He has leadership. I'll give you that he has leadership. And he has vision. In that Watford game, when Kapoe scored the first goal.
Amazing goal.
What happened was, I think Miguel Britos,
yes.
He challenged Marcel. Marcel went down, players were waiting for the referee to call it a foul.
But it was
and
a fair challenge.
It was a fair challenge, played on. And in fact, no one from United actually protested. You know? It was just Marcel there lying down.
Yeah.
Like he'd given up on himself, really. So, you had Bailey, Smalling, and Shaw focusing so much on Jean-Marc and,
yeah.
And Britos. No one was looking at Kapoe coming from behind. But Rooney saw it, you know. Rooney was like 20.
He was the only person running back.
He was the only person who had the vision who knew, oh my god, this is going to be a fucked up situation.
Like,
he ran back. He was not there. He was not there to actually demonstrate his leadership skills.
So if you're saying that if he was played deeper,
in a deeper
he could
position.
Have been not.
I tell you what's wrong with our back four. Our back four is top notch. Smalling is a rock. Bailey is a rock. Supposedly they can recreate the days of Vidic and Ferdinand.
Well, they are a rock.
But
they
I tell you what's
rock.
Different from them and Vidic and Ferdinand. They don't have leadership. Even though Smalling came from Ferguson's generation, there are only so many people with that charisma. Rooney is one of them. They need someone to command them.
Okay, so you're saying if Rooney goes back deeper down, that's going
to
be...
Rooney has to go back deeper down because he is running out of time. He needs to make sure he uses the time he has left to teach them how to be leaders.
Okay, but listen first. Once he goes back down, he's going to be around the central defensive midfield. Okay, so where are you going to put the rest of your CDMs? Where's Fellaini going to go? Where's
Fellaini doesn't deserve to be in
the
game, man.
From
the
game. Yeah, exactly.
It's way too comfortable for Fellaini and Pop. It will be way too comfortable for them. Because there's no competition in there. You know? I'll start whoever I want. That's our manager's approach.
Well, that's Mourinho.
So Mourinho doesn't allow growth in such a sequence of game. You know, I mean, he doesn't start the same team for 10 times.
Mm.
So, in the end, we're all in agreement, yeah? Instead of being a defensive striker, perhaps he could become a defensive midfielder.
And I have to say this, I respect Rooney because...
He's still there.
He is willing to compromise his striker position and play in other positions. He's like,
yeah.
Coach, tell me where you want me to play. I'll play...
He used to be a stubborn player.
That was the case for England. Well.
He used to be a very stubborn player, especially
yeah,
when he was with Everton back then.
He totally changed since that City fiasco. He totally changed since then. His attitude has changed so much. I'm
also,
very proud of him.
One thing that we need to talk about Rooney, his passes in the last few games have been
miserable. He has lost the precision.
So
I will admit that.
Where does he go from there?
I don't know. I don't think even if he goes to that MSL, will he try?
Fuck it!
I don't think so. I don't think he will even try.
He
ran too much on the field. It's taking a toll on his body. Because he's always everywhere. Do you realize that?
When was the last time he had a really major injury that was out like 4 or 5
very
months?
Very rare. He's one of those rare players who hardly get injuries.
He's like Gerrard. Gerrard also rarely gets injuries. But
only
towards the end of his career.
That's why you can see Gerrard dropping towards the end.
Yeah.
Because it took a toll on his body.
So this
wow.
is the same thing that's happening towards
wow.
Wayne Rooney.
A Man United fan defended Gerrard though.
Now, let's go to Spain and talk about La Liga's major teams and their respective form right now, yeah? So, Johan, first I'd like to apologize to you about the old Manchester United thing. You look a bit depressed right now, so... There.
Tabah.
So, let's just talk about Real Madrid right now. Real Madrid recently...
One of their best starts to the season.
No, they had better starts.
No, this is one of their best starts.
Oh.
And they're not... Here's the point, they're not relying too much on Bale and Ronaldo.
Ooh! Oh, really?
Yeah.
Ronaldo is still not being
played
regularly.
He's playing already.
He's
not playing
already.
Okay, tell me more about this. Because I recently am not caught up with the Spanish league, and I felt as though Real Madrid wasn't really at their best. But
okay.
Since you're telling me that they're not relying on Cristiano and Bale right now, what's different right now?
Okay, look at their scores. 13 goals in 5 games. And I think only a few will have been scored by Bale and Ronaldo.
Mm.
So if you look at this run of form, Neymar one of their best seasons and they're not even relying on them. And they are allowing a lot of other usually you don't see them in the regular lineup to kind of play. I want to talk about James Rodriguez because he was actually sidelined for quite some time.
Because he was not allowed to play under Zidane.
What happened to him, maybe?
Don't know what happened.
Did he drop or was it?
No. It's not a drop. It's just sometimes when you don't see a value in a player anymore, right? They just throw you away, unfortunately. And for Real Madrid's case especially, they are a team abundant with stars.
James Rodriguez is just one of them.
So unless you're fit for the team, basically what they're trying to say is unless you're fit for the team, you're going to be offloaded.
Yeah.
But Rodriguez actually worked his way up this time.
That's what I really respected of Rodriguez in that game.
Nice, very nice. Moving, they sit on top of the table right now.
Yes.
Then, surprisingly, what's next is second place is Sevilla, if I'm not mistaken. Sevilla second.
And they're doing well without Gamero.
I think a few podcasts ago, like, CK was shitting on them, right? But then again, it's La Liga, la, you know?
That's true.
Hey, CK, I think this is karma for you, la, huh? The whole Liverpool game?
Okay, moving on to... moving on to Barcelona, they drew against Atletico Madrid 1-1. Beautiful game. Very, very nice game. It kind of reminded me of... we're talking about Atletico against Bilbao.
Yes.
Yeah. It was something of a similar quality. Man of the match for Atletico Madrid for me was Oblak.
Yes,
oh,
Oblak.
Yeah, he was a really good keeper in that game. I tell you, Neymar tried to shoot all these amazingly accurate shots from like 20, 30 yards.
Amazingly accurate.
It's like, you know, like shots on target and Oblak just keep... Catching them.
And MSN couldn't even get past him.
Which is very impressive.
Yeah, it's very nice. It was very nice to see. But this Barca team, interestingly, in this game, I think it was, it was an SMS. SMS, right?
MSN. Messi, Suarez, Neymar.
Hey, come on, SMS, D! Bro!
Bro!
I was just about to say that.
Yeah, it was MSN. So you can see the difference, right?
Yeah.
On one side, you have a Real Madrid that's not relying too much on Bale and Ronaldo. And then on the other hand, you have a team where when they feel a second team, they lose to Alaves. So, my question really is if this is Real Madrid season. Carl, what do you think?
I think it is. Because I think they really found it something to work to build on after Ancelotti left.
And I think to add on to Kyle, Zidane is very, very well versed with the framework of how Madrid works.
He's Madrid in and out.
And it will be their season because of the fact that this is going to be one of these seasons where a manager knows the team so well that they'll push them to victory.
And let's not forget one more thing. Yeah, the M in MSN is getting older. He's becoming a very wily player. He's becoming a player that's not performing as consistently as he's been doing over the past, 7-8 years?
Well, sometimes you want the player playing who he is now rather than what he was 5 days ago.
True. And sometimes you need to fight your way back to the FIFA cover.
But again, Messi plays a big part in Barcelona's attack. And with him slowly becoming a bit more redundant in what Barcelona wants. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if they start experimenting around with that position.
I don't think they have to worry. Neymar, he's still there.
Who was it?
There is as in like his performance.
No disrespect to La Liga, you know, like the bottom half of the team, the bottom 10 teams, you can put Messi there against that bottom 10. So he will get games and he will be happy. It's just the games against Atletico, Sevilla, all this dangerous
team.
The top half. The top 6 teams are the ones that Messi does want to play. But he has to prove himself.
Just a quick update on Atletico Madrid's position. They currently sit in 4th place. Just mind you, with 9 points, okay, 5 games, they scored 11 goals and only conceded 2.
2?
Yeah.
That's what Diego Simeone is well renowned for.
So,
playing
compact defense. I have to highlight this to you. This was not a typical defensive game from Madrid. It was just like what Bilbao did. Constant attacking from both sides.
Oh wow.
That's interesting.
So yeah, Simeone has given a chance by upper management to do something that he wants to do, paid in dividends.
And look at that. Look at what's happening right now.
I think he learned the lesson from the first 2 games.
Because I think it does not justify Atletico Madrid in the first 2 games and the fact that they did not play how Simeone would have normally played.
Yeah, but it's good for them. They're getting results. It's very nice to see. Moving on to the German league. Bundesliga.
Yes. Okay, so fun fact, guys. Can you guess the bottom 2 teams right now of the Bundesliga?
Schalke and Werder Bremen.
Exactly! It's Schalke and Werder Bremen. Oh my god.
Where are the first? Nah, names like Red Bull Leipzig and
Red Bull Leipzig is 6!
Ooh, damn. Ingolstadt.
Guess who's second?
Hey, don't forget 1 point towards the end of the first half of the season for Bundesliga. Hoffenheim was on top.
Again. Guess who's second?
No,
currently second.
Wolfsburg?
Nope.
Not down.
Don't even know how to pronounce the club name.
Ingolstadt.
Ingolstadt is somewhere around 8, 9.
Darmstadt.
That's why you're freaking out.
No, there's a name for Darmstadt.
There is.
They are called goats.
Cologne.
Exactly.
Wait, wasn't Cologne? Didn't Cologne come into the season this season?
Last season.
Fuck. No, but they have an easy run of fixtures.
So far.
Okay. Yeah, they're
keeper.
Like, two more games.
Timo Horn is one to watch for.
Yes.
Timo Horn. Yeah, let's not talk about the Stegen anymore because he decides to. He has succumbed to the fact that he will stay in Barcelona forever on the bench.
It's damn sad for him. They talking about the Stegen.
He wants to stay there. Fuck him. Stay there. Lah. All
right. With that being said, then let's go into the games.
Talking about the Stegen going to Milan.
Okay. In this top set, in this Bundesliga top set, we're going to be talking about two teams in general. Yeah?
Dortmund
and Schalke. Dortmund, after the loss to Red Bull, they have had a string of 3 wins.
Redemption!
Huh?
Seriously, what happened? Is it just the Bundesliga? Or...
And you know, right, in the Darmstadt game where they beat... Was it Ingolstadt or not? Darmstadt, I can't remember. They beat 6-0, one of the Stars. They beat them 6-0. Aubameyang was not playing.
Here's one more thing. In the last 3 games, Dortmund has scored 17 goals.
Yeah, that's fucking impressive.
Ivan is like, what the fuck is going on?
So, in general, we see Dortmund as a team that they... how do I say this? They like to play the beautiful game.
Dortmund is.
Possession with progression.
Exactly, possession with progression.
Which is the Gegenpressing. Which is the framework that Klopp left to Tuchel.
Gegenpressing.
He always ties it back to the
Liverpool. It's Gegenpressing. No, unfortunately, this one has to be tied back to Liverpool.
No, but this one is how Klopp plays, even when they've won the season, like what?
Like,
I don't see Gegenpressing, though.
To me, there is
a counter.
It's a hybrid kind of Gegenpressing.
It's a Tuchel philosophy.
Yes. I mean, what I feel like is...
He put Klopp's framework into his hands.
But in my, from what I've seen so far, I feel like they're playing a very... I really don't want to say this because I'm afraid of the backlash from the three of you, especially you and you. But they're playing a very tiki-taka style.
It has always been like that. Gegenpressing has been like tiki-taka.
Like,
it's an improved
version of tiki-taka that has actually gotten the results.
Yeah.
Carl, you agree?
It's what the German FA wanted when they did the whole restructuring of the football.
We talked about it before with Kavin and Kajin.
So it's what teams should be playing.
Yeah.
Mm.
So you're expected to play like Dortmund in the Bundesliga.
Yeah. I mean, like the German national team.
Is Bayern
playing
like that?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, is that Ancelotti's style of playing right now?
No, I don't feel like that.
I don't feel that's the case for Bayern Munich.
But when
the current season?
Not in the current season, but back in the days,
yes.
Back when Guardiola was still there, yes. They played a style of tiki-taka that is very different, but similar to the German
style.
Which
didn't suit Bayern Munich, mind you. Right.
But they still won. They still won.
Yeah, they still won because the league was not competitive.
And okay,
it is still not competitive then.
But,
in comparison to other leagues, it's not as competitive. But right now, slowly but surely, we can see all the German teams getting more and more better.
Some of the teams deteriorated because they lost their key players. Schalke definitely deteriorating because of the fact that...
So who's still in Schalke right now aside from Hunter?
Yeah!
Don't be Hunter lah, shit!
Uchida.
Actually, we're going to the Schalke later lah, but I have a list of people. I have a list of people who've left.
Okay, so Dortmund.
Dortmund, there's two players I want to talk about right now. There's a third player later on, but there's Guerrero and Dembele.
Played very well against.
I think Castro, you should mention Castro as well.
Gonzalo Castro.
Yeah.
Gonzalo Castro, yes.
He scored two goals.
He's a perfect addition to the team, but I feel like the pairing of
Guerrero
and Dembele is amazing because Guerrero is the type of player who knows when to, sacrifice himself in a sense so that he can create space for players like Dembele.
May I say something, a quick one about Gonzalo Castro?
Yes,
Gonzalo Castro, I've been keeping an eye on him since his days at Bayer Leverkusen because he was bought from Bayer Leverkusen. He played throughout his career, if I'm mistaken, correct me if I'm wrong, from a right back to a right wing. Now he's playing
center mid.
So he has that experience of let's just put a comparison, like a lamb, for example.
Lamb
transition from those positions, but now he's fully at a right back.
It's a metaphor.
You know, so Gonzalo Castro, he has, and also he played under a lot of coaches. I think he finally found a coach that believes in his abilities and his brain.
I think it's just, and also Gundogan leaving to City opened up a spot for him.
Exactly.
Another player is, I want to point out right now, is Mr. Pulisic, please. Julian Weigl.
Are you fucking serious?
Weigl conceded the goal against Wolfsburg. He was poor defending from Weigl's side. And it was only that one time.
No.
Have you seen him playing the other times right now?
Yeah.
In, okay. I just
want to add
All right. He went from a developmental player to a first team, to a first team player in just one season.
But so was Pulisic.
My hope for Pulisic is that he doesn't get caught up in the hype. I really hope.
Yeah, he's American. It's definitely gonna happen.
Yeah.
If you're American playing abroad, dude, the hype is gonna get to you.
But one thing about Wiggle that I want to point out is that he brings range and accurate passes to a team that really depends on
Wiggle.
Yeah, especially if you watch the last game.
I think Castro will be a better.
I agree. I mean, I'm not saying that Wiggle is the key player right now, but I'm saying that he's someone to watch out.
Early on, we were talking about combination pairing. There we go.
All right, next. I really don't want to talk about this because it's actually a very sad story, but we have to.
Just tell us who left Schalke first.
Raul.
Okay.
Apart from Raul, at you.
Okay. Leroy Sané, Christian Clemens,
Drexler,
Robert Lepers, Drexler, Joel Matip.
Christian Fuchs.
Yes.
So that's a very small list of the amount of players that have left. What's it called? Schalke in the past few years.
Neuer.
Because it's been a while, but man, that was painful.
That was painful.
Heiko Westermann.
Oh.
So I want to point this out. Yeah. In the year of 2015,
those names.
UEFA actually said that Schalke was the 7th best team in Europe.
Antla leading them, man.
It does.
It feels like the same situation all over again right now here in the German league.
It's painful, don't you think?
I never
heard about that. Werder Bremen. Like, how? We were just hyping them up before the season started, you know.
It's just like a sense of pitches curse or something.
Yeah.
I think it is.
Okay, so we're gonna hype on Chelsea and Liverpool and...
Hey!
Now, can we hype on Stoke?
back to the Bundesliga. What's happening, guys? I mean, what is wrong with them right now? Minus level players. I don't feel like they should be performing this week, especially with the club being at where they are financially.
I'm just waiting for Bayern Munich to lose a game. Because I really want to see Dortmund win.
I mean, in the future, if it's possible, I can call a friend of mine who lives in New York. He's a German. From Bremen, actually. He's a lifelong Bremen friend. So hopefully in the future, you guys can interview him.
Alright, sounds good.
To get more in-depth insight what's going on with Bremen.
Yeah, because right now, from...
Everyone's dressing their heads.
Yeah. Alright, so that ends up our reports on the Bundesliga. Let's come back to somewhere that's a bit more closer to home.
Yeah.
Somewhere more closer to us. Okay, Khal, I think we might want you to lead this. It's a congratulatory talk set for JDT.
JDT, what can you say? They came in with a plan, and they're currently succeeding the plan. What they want by maybe in next year or the following year to be
the best team.
Not only best team, to be the best team with merit. I have
a question for you. Although it might sound like it will be rhetoric.
Okay.
Do you think the more successful JDT becomes, the more miserable Malaysia will be in the international football scene?
No, I don't think so. I think what I actually expected, and the reality of it, is really disappointing. When JDT happened, I mean, when the success happened in the first and second season, now the third season, winning the title, I thought that JDT would have told everyone in the league, even FAM, in a sense, step up your game or we're going to run away with the league every year. Give us a challenge. The only challenge that we can seek is AFC Cup and possibly in the future, the Asian Champions League.
Yeah.
Mm. The gap between JDT and the rest of the clubs in the Malaysian league is
huge.
The disparity is very bad right now. That's true. That is true.
Huge.
And with more players, I think, I'm going to repeat your point again, hopefully. I think here is what I want to say is, if everyone wants to play for JDT and then follow their mantra of we should not follow FAM, then Malaysia is...
Which goes back to my question. Is this healthy? And we all know the obvious answer is that it's not healthy.
It's just
how do you come to a consensus?
Okay. Very simple. We were actually talking about this the other day.
Very simple. Get DMJ to be the president.
He has admittedly said that if he becomes president, you'll be biased.
We were talking about this the other day in terms of how the Malaysian football scene should prosper. Not should prosper, but what steps they should take from now on. The social leagues. Okay, because right now, as everyone of us have known, and to what we know so far, and well, Khal is already very worn down by this.
Mm.
We know how bad of a league we have here in Malaysia.
Oh, yeah.
And the only way to pick it back up is to go back to the grassroots, to go back down to where it all started.
When that day, a few weeks ago, in fact, when I messaged you guys saying that you guys want to come in for Selangor Champions League, yeah, whatever you want to.
Technically, you called.
Contacted, alright. Technical terms. A lot of my friends within the social, the Malaysian football, Bolasepak Twitter Jaya, man, they noticed that quite a lot of us has been very fatigued. Honestly, you ask anyone, this has been the most longest season that we ever felt. In terms of the drama, in terms of whatever.
Yeah, I think it's taking a toll to every fan.
Everyone. I mean, if you look at how everyone's like tweeting, social media, I mean, Facebooking, whatever, semua, there's a, do I really want to do this? Mood.
I mean, take a look at both Padanbolasepak and also Semunya Bola.
Tifo as well.
Tifo.
Tifo.
Tifo. Lady, yeah. Yes. Tifo has been really quiet really now. And after Semunya Bola's account was suspended as well.
Hmm. You know, even the tweet bowler curators pun macam try to avoid.
I mean, it's a safer thing.
Malaysian football because everyone letih. Semua letih.
It's an interesting thing to talk about. Yes. So I mean, I don't want to make this like a what's it called coming to promote SEL, but Khal and I were at the Selangor Champions League game on
Tuesday.
We were watching
2 Tuesdays ago and also the recent Tuesday.
Yeah, the recent Tuesday. This was without Ivy. So we were watching the Selangor boys play Alam Muda. You could see how well both teams were actually playing, and sure they might not be the best teams out there, but honestly, it's a refreshing thing to watch because you can actually see all the teams having a draft to play.
But how do you get the other state FAs to come up with similar initiatives as well?
Very simple. Get this one successful first.
Yes.
Very simple.
So you're saying if Selangor Champions League becomes a success 3 years, 4 years down the road, the other state FAs will attempt to
definitely. It takes one small step for a giant step to be taken.
Or you could even take a small spark from lighter to start fire.
Exactly.
Wow.
So I've always been a big believer that change should happen from the bottom top rather than top bottom. This is from grassroots beyond.
Yeah.
You know, so I think
I
what Selangor Champions League are doing, they're doing a
very good job.
Good job so
very
far.
Good.
You know, we will continue to support them.
Which also you guys should check out their YouTube channel.
And
they don't just upload the pundits, they also upload highlights. And I'm also amazed to see that.
Highlights, interviews.
And another thing about this was, I think I'll bring back to 2 weeks ago when I interviewed he made a very good point about gaining exposure. With these matches, with more and more social media exposure, scouts are going to come in.
Mm.
And players who have lost their chance to play for Malaysia will be able to redeem themselves one more time. And that would be one of the most refreshing sights that Malaysian football needs right now.
That is true.
Agreed, totally.
What a way to end the podcast. Shout out to Selangor Champions League. And,
I'll come next week, guys.
Yeah,
I promise.
This next Thursday night, 29th of September, is Clasico FC versus
Shalom Boys.
Yes. That's going to be a fantastic game.
And if you guys who are listening to this, if you guys can make it down to
New Camp,
Padanbolasepak. Do come down. The more the merrier. And honestly, trust us, the game is going to be a really good game.
And don't watch it in a sense where you guys think that, oh, straight away it's one of the matches like JDT style or JDT level. No. Watch it in your standpoint.
Remember
yes.
why you started playing football, futsal.
Same thing as you come to watch this match. Please do come and support the style.
Take it with a pinch of salt.
Hey, fuck you guys. Before please do come and support the Star Wars Champions League. I think the fact that you guys, if you guys were to make it to watch the match, players will be motivated to give you a very good show.
Thank you so much, Khal.
Thank you,
Khal. Padanbolasepak, for joining us in this podcast.
What
a way to end a podcast with a lot of emotions and disappointment.
Don't cry, Iwan.
The only disappointment is Manchester United. Continue.
Until next is Iwan.
Do we have to do predictions?
Predictions, no need lah.
Arsenal, Chelsea, yo.
Clasico atau Selangor Boys?
Clasico, I don't know.
Clasico atau Selangor Boys?
Clasico
5-1.
You know why Clasico or not? Because last week they played against the team where they look like Atletico Madrid. I want to see that again. I like the Jersey.
But yeah, that's it, guys.
You know what?
What's your prediction?
Chelsea, win.
Kappa?
Okay. 3-1.
Oh.
God? Let me flip a coin. Chelsea, Arsenal.
Okay.
If it's Berlin, draw.
Okay, the point.
Balance.
Arsenal.
Oh.
The coins has said it.
Okay, I'm going to follow the coins. So I want to ask you this. What's your score prediction?
If Arsenal goes through. I'm willing to move my coins.
Maybe you want?
I think it's going to be a tight win for Chelsea. 1-0.
I have a feeling it's a boring game. 0-0. Still me. Goalless draw.
So next week we will see Yuhan being screamed at by Izam. Shame.
No. Arsenal's gonna lose and they're gonna get a red card because of Diego Costa again. And you, who's the referee for this match?
Alright, so until then, this is Yuhan.
This is Izam.
Yes, sir.
this is Henry. This is also Henry.
Alright, Khal here.
Alright, okay, let's go. No close.